Heavenly Father, we thank you for tonight, Lord. We know that there's no accidents in your kingdom and that each person here, Lord, is here by your divine providence. We pray, Lord, that you'll just reveal your word to us. Tell us, each person here, Lord, the message that you have for them specifically from your book of Ezekiel, Lord. We know that the entire Bible was written by your inspiration, Lord. It's your word, perfect, flawless, without error. We thank you for it, Lord. We pray you'll just watch over us. We know that you're among us. And we pray that you'll teach us and help us to examine ourselves, Lord, and help us to be better people, serving you and praising and worshiping you in everything we do. In Jesus' name, amen. So, Ezekiel, can you start the slides for us? If we could say the theme of Ezekiel is the sovereignty and glory of God. We've already seen a lot about his sovereignty and how God keeps doing things and showing people what's going to happen and how it's going to happen, which is going to speak to his sovereignty throughout the book. And we also see the glory of God, where it talks about him dwelling between the cherubim, and we see the glory, and we're going to see what God does tonight as he moves through that. Ezekiel chapter 9, also one of the, you might say, themes of Ezekiel is know that I am the Lord. And I looked, I had said the last time I was up here that that occurs 70 times in the book of Ezekiel, and I actually think it does. It's interesting, I saw one commentator who said 70 times, but then I saw the same commentator years later and he said 54. And I thought, well, something's not right here. So I looked, I counted 63. So my guess is I missed a few, and it's probably 70, because we know God and the number 7 and 70s in the Bible. So I suspect it's 70, but whether it's 63 or 70, it doesn't really matter. That's a whole lot of times in the book of Ezekiel. And I think God has a message for both, not only for them, but also for us, that he is indeed Lord of Lords, King of Kings, and he's ruling and reigning over this earth and the entire universe. So before we started chapter 9, I thought we'd do a quick review of chapter 8. Chapter 9 is really a continuation of chapter 8, and obviously I'm not going to go into detail about the whole chapter, but chapter 8 opens up, and it came to pass in the sixth year, in the sixth month, in the fifth day of the month, as I sat in mine house, and the elders of Judah sat before me. So we see he wasn't at the river Kibar now. He's actually in his house, and the elders, the leaders that are in captivity there outside the city of Babylon are there with him in his house, which is probably, hopefully, a good sign. That the hand of the Lord God fell there upon me, and he put forth the form of a hand and took me by a lock of mine head, and the Spirit lifted me up between the heaven and the earth and brought me in visions of God to Jerusalem. So Ezekiel is transported in a vision by God to Jerusalem, and he's going to see a lot of things going down there that God's going to show him. These abominations, idol worship of the people, the leaders, the priest. We see the image of jealousy in verse 5, creeping things, beasts, and idols portrayed on the wall, which probably means they were carved into the wall and admired and worshiped. Incense being offered to idols and false gods in verse 11, women weeping for Tammuz in verse 14, which had something to do with fertility. These may have been actual prostitutes for Tammuz. And then it winds up there, so to speak, with the worshiping of the sun, which was taking place actually in the inner court of the temple by the priests. So you kind of see just how far these people had fallen. And obviously they've fallen into that kind of famous saying we hear, worshiping the creature rather than the creator. They're worshiping the sun and stuff rather than the God who made all of them. And I think it's important for us to ask ourselves, you know, we think of idols as, you know, something ancient where people had some carved image or something they were worshiping, but there's all kind of idols, and I mean, they're rampant in every country of the world, and I think it's important for us to ask ourselves, do we have any idols in our lives? And if you don't think you do, I think it's a great idea to prayerfully ask God if there is any idol in your life, to please show it to you and help you to deal with it. And if you ask him in sincerity, he will show you. And there's been lots of people who wound up with lots of surprises because something was actually an idol to them that they didn't realize. So if you sincerely seek God and ask him to do that, I fully believe he'll show you And then not only that, but he's such a good God and a good father, he'll also help you to get rid of it. So with that kind of background, let's go into chapter 9, verse 1. Then he called out in my hearing with a loud voice, saying, "Let those who have charge over the city draw near, each with a deadly weapon in his hand." And suddenly six men came from the direction of the upper gate, which faces north, each with his battle axe in his hand. One man among them was clothed with linen and had a writer's inkhorn at his side. They went in and stood beside the bronze altar. So linen is a symbol of rank. So this guy is probably in charge in some sort of a way. We'll also see he has some other special duties. These men are probably angels. It could be men, but it's probably angels for lots of reasons. In 2 Samuel chapters 24, David had numbered the people and had really upset God. And God sent an angel to smote the people. And if you look there, you'll see that angel is called a man. So, I mean, we see this throughout kind of the Bible. But this one in linen is probably going to be a scribe. He's going to record. He's also, we're going to see, he's going to mark the people. And we see the six men. We wonder if that's the six angels who are sort of over Jerusalem. Because in lots of places in the Bible, we see where an angel is over or behind the power of a king or a city or some of this kind of stuff. Daniel chapter 10, when Gabriel comes to Daniel, he says that he was delayed because he was fighting with the prince of Persia, and then Michael came and helped him fight so he could get to Daniel, and he said, "And when I leave, I'm going to have to fight the prince of Greece." So I don't think he's talking about fighting a human being. I mean, there's angels behind all of these powers. And I suspect, the text doesn't tell us, so I'm not saying for sure, but I suspect these may be the six angels who were sort of the overseers of the city of Jerusalem. Moving on to verse 3. Now the glory of God, the God of Israel, had gone up from the cherub where it had been to the threshold of the temple, and he called to the man clothed with linen who had the writer's inkhorn at his side. And the Lord said to him, "Go through the midst of the city, through the midst of Jerusalem, and put a mark on the foreheads of the men who sigh and cry over all the abominations that are done within it." So here in verse 3, where it's interesting, now we're going to see, it says the glory of the God of Israel had gone up from the cherub where it had been. That's where God had been dwelling with the people. And we're actually seeing now stage one as he's going to depart. Not only the temple, but he's actually going to wind up departing Jerusalem, which is really heartbreaking when you see this. So we'll see this unfold as we go on. It's also interesting that this man in linen is going to put this mark on the foreheads of men who sigh and cry over all the abominations that are done within it. So I think we have to remember, at this point in time, Jeremiah is still in Jerusalem. So probably no doubt, Jeremiah is going to be one of the ones getting one of those marks. The people who were lamenting over the sins of Israel certainly included Jeremiah, so he was probably one of them that would be marked. But this marking of men is actually very, very interesting. If we look, here we have in Ezekiel 9:4 a mark on the foreheads of men. If we look back at Genesis chapter 4, verse 15, "And the Lord set a mark on Cain, lest anyone finding him should kill him." And then in Psalm 37:37 we find, "Mark the blameless man and observe the upright, for the future of that man is peace." And I find this really, really interesting because we're going to see a verse in a minute on the next slide where you can actually see that verse is prophetic. Because what does God do when he saves us? When we come to him and confess our sin nature and all of our sins and ask him and believe on him and ask him to forgive us and be our Lord and Savior, we're marked. And we'll see that in Ephesians in a minute. So I kind of thought it was kind of interesting because you can certainly see that verse as prophetic, which is really cool. But then kind of looking at the dark side, Revelation 13, 16, and 17, he causes all, both small and great, rich and poor, free and slave, to receive a mark on their right hand or on their foreheads, and that no one may buy or sell except one who has the mark or the name of the beast or the number of his name. And then in Revelation 14, 9 through 11, "Then a third angel followed them, saying with a loud voice, 'If anyone worships the beast and his image and receives his mark on his forehead or on his hand. He himself shall also drink of the wine of the wrath of God, which is poured out full strength into the cup of his indignation. He shall be tormented with fire and brimstone in the presence of the holy angels and in the presence of the Lamb. And the smoke of their torment ascends forever and ever, and they have no rest day or night who worship the beast and his image and whoever receives the mark of his name. So everyone's familiar with the 666 in Revelation and the mark of the beast. It's really interesting here to see that we see where God's marking people, and now the Antichrist is actually marking people. This is probably not just a simple mark. I personally believe it's probably some kind of carbon nanotubes involved with a computer chip, which probably changes people's DNA, because there's something going on there, because once these people take that mark, they're unredeemable. God says they have chosen that way, and there's no salvation for them once they do that. So something's very much changing there. And I think the other message to remember is the key to that mark is, and receiving his mark and swearing allegiance to him, whoever receives the mark of his name. It's really about swearing allegiance to this guy and saying, basically, you're God, I'm going to follow you, I believe in you, all this. So if you're receiving something, a tattoo or whatever, and you're not swearing allegiance, it's cool. Don't worry, it's not the mark. this phraseology also occurs four more times in Revelation concerning the mark of the beast, which is kind of interesting. But note the mark of his name. And if we look again, delve into this marking business a little bit more. If we go to Revelation chapter 7, verses 2 and 3, it says, "Then I saw another angel ascending from the east, having the seal of the living God." So we're back to the good marks now. "And he cried with a loud voice to the four angels to whom it was granted to harm the earth and the sea, saying, 'Do not harm the earth, the sea, or the trees, till we have sealed the servants of our God on their foreheads.'" So this is very reminiscent of what's going on here in Ezekiel, where all these people are idolatrous and are going to be destroyed, but God's marking the ones who are repentant and who realize what's going on and how much they've disappointed and their rebellion and all. And we're seeing this sort of same theme there in Revelation here. This mark, by the way, is for the 144,000. It's the 12,000 from each tribe of Jacob is who they're talking about. And then in Revelation 3, this is to the church at Philadelphia, one of the seven letters to seven churches. "He who overcomes, I will make him a pillar in the temple of my God, and he shall go out no more. I will write on him the name of my God and the name of the city of my God, the New Jerusalem, which comes down out of heaven from my God. And I will write on him my new name. He who has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit says to the churches." Notice that's churches. It's not just to the church at Philadelphia. If you'll notice, all seven of those letters are to the churches. They were expected to be shared because there's application from each letter to all the church, just as there is from each of those letters to us. But it's really interesting here that they're going to get a mark. And I actually looked up in Greek what the word seal is used here. I actually looked it up in Greek to see what that means. It means to set a seal upon or to mark with a seal. So again, they're being marked. It doesn't say the forehead here, but that's probably the case. And then I saved the first one on this slide for last. And this is from Ephesians. Now this is talking specifically of us, we who are Christians. "In him you also trusted, after you heard the word of truth, the gospel of your salvation, in whom also, having believed, you were sealed with the Holy Spirit of promise." So we were actually sealed or marked by God when he redeemed us and we were saved. He set a mark upon us. It's not visible, probably is to him, but so we've got a mark too. So when you think about these good marks and these bad marks going on mankind, it's really kind of interesting. And if you think about that in perspective, if you'll notice, God's mark in every single case was always to preserve and to save. And Satan's mark, as we know, always brings death, destruction, and hell. Really sad to see that contrast. But you see here one of Satan's imitations. And it's interesting because Satan seems to kind of counterfeit everything God is up to. And it's really amazing. So as I was researching this, I found something that I found really, really interesting on Satan's counterfeits. And this is from J.O. Sanders. Satan has his own trinity, the devil, the Antichrist, and the false prophet. He has his own church, the synagogue of Satan. He has his own ministers, the ministers of Satan. He has formulated his own system of theology, doctrines of demons, which we see in 1 Timothy. All these verses are up here. He has established his own sacrificial system, the Gentiles sacrifice to demons. There's actually a lot of sacrifice going on to demons in our world today, I'm very sad to say. He has his own communion service, the cup of demons and the table of demons. His ministers proclaim his own gospel, a gospel contrary to that which we have preached to you. He has his own throne and his own worshipers. So he has developed a thorough imitation of Christianity viewed as a system of religion. And if you think about the Antichrist with this deadly head wound, he even counterfeits a resurrection. In his role as the imitator of God, he inspires false Christ and self-constituted messiahs. We've seen some of those over the past few decades. And lastly, he employs false teachers who are specialists in his quote-unquote theology to bring in destructive heresies, even denying the master who brought them. So the world is largely falling for Satan's counterfeit. So I think it's important for us to be on our guard and to recognize him when we see him and to call him out to people. You know, it's amazing, so many people who deny Christianity and the Bible, and then you look at the things that they believe and you just can't help but scratch your head at some of the most ridiculous, bizarre stuff imaginable. And you're like, how can you can't believe the God of the Bible, but you can believe that? It just makes no sense, which, you know, just tells us the degree and the level of deception that's at play in the world. And only God can set them free. Only he can open their eyes. So we have to pray that, you know, he'll open their eyes and that they'll hear and be saved. So I was thinking about this mark, and I ran across a couple guys who said the mark was believed to be a cross, the sign of a cross, in ancient Hebrew. And I'm taking Hebrew very slowly, but, and I thought, no, the last letter of the Hebrew alphabet, it's the tau, it's the last letter of the Hebrew alphabet, and I thought, the last letter of the Hebrew alphabet looks nothing like a cross. You can't even bend it to look like a cross. So I thought, well, you know, there's got to be something to this for so many people to be mentioning this. So I went into research mode and stumbled onto something that I think is wonderful. If you look at Paleo Hebrew, which would have been the form of Hebrew that they were using back in Ezekiel's time, on the far left of your screen, you will see the letter tau at that time and how it has morphed over, what, probably three millennia. It's had 3,000 years for the Hebrew alphabet to change. So it went from a cross to kind of an X sign and then something closer to what the modern tau is. And then on the other side of the screen is the tau. And it's interesting, it says the history and construction of this letter. The ancient picture or cross is a type of mark, probably two sticks crossed to mark a place, similar to the Egyptian hieroglyph of the plus. So, you know, even as kids, what do? When we want to mark something as ours, sometimes you'll put in a cross on it, which it might be an X. And if you think about it, also kids and people will take two sticks and they usually lay one across the other to mark something on the ground or some place. So it just, to me, it just all falls right into place. And I just thought that was absolutely fascinating about Paleo Hebrew. So I thought that was pretty interesting that it's very strongly believed and certainly a lot of evidence that this mark that was put on their forehead was actually the sign of a cross. So getting back to Ezekiel chapter 9, verse 5, to the others he said in my hearing, go after him through the city and kill. Do not let your eye spare, nor have any pity. Utterly slay old and young men, maidens and little children and women, but do not come near anyone on whom is the mark. And begin at my sanctuary. So they began with the elders who were before the temple. It's really interesting how God always seems to start at his house when he's going to purge or bring judgment. And And we certainly see that here. Then he said to them, "Defile the temple and fill the courts with the slain. Go out." And they went out and killed in the city. It's interesting because Levitically, he tells them to put the dead bodies in the temple. Levitically speaking, that would totally defile the temple because of the dead bodies. Because, you know, they couldn't even go near a dead body. If they went near a dead body, they were defiled, and they had to go through this whole cleansing process. And if it was one of the Jewish holidays, they couldn't participate if they were defiled. So a dead body was a big deal to them. And to see God say, put it in the temple, kind of leaves you scratching your head until you realize God was painting a symbol for them. It's like you've defiled the temple with this idol worship and with all this stuff you're doing. You want the temple defiled? We'll defile the temple. And he tells them to put these dead bodies in there, which is a tremendous sign of their spiritual defilement. But moving on. "So it was that while they were killing them, I was left alone, and I fell on my face and cried out and said, 'Ah, Lord God, will you destroy all the remnant of Israel in pouring out your fury on Jerusalem?'" One thing we have to remember, this actually hasn't happened yet. This is Ezekiel's vision, and it's actually the Babylonians who will be used to go through and kill people. So kind of keep that in mind. But Ezekiel is seeing this vision of what's going to happen. And remember those angels behind the power. So there's probably a lot at play here because we know how God put his angels over us and over cities and powers and principalities and all that stuff. And they're certainly at play here. But the instrument of his judgment, as he said many times in Ezekiel and Jeremiah, is the Babylonians. So we see this judgment falling now. They're found in defilement and sin without God. And we know that all in that state die. And I think the application for us, we're saved, so we don't have to worry about, we're not going to die the second death. But God certainly doesn't want us living in sin, in some kind of a defilement. He died for us, he set us free from that, and we don't want to be like that. And 1 John 1:9 has been called the Christian's bar of soap, which says, he is faithful, if we will confess our sins to him, to forgive us our sins. And I think it's important when, as we're seeing all this judgment and defilement and all this stuff, to realize there's forms of that that can be applicable to us too, and we need to be very, very careful and be honest with ourselves about what we're doing and what God may be telling us and what we need to do to get purified by him through the blood of Jesus for those things. It's also interesting, as I said earlier, he began with the elders at the temple. 1 Peter 4:17 says, "For the time has come for judgment to begin at the house of God. And if it begins with us first, what will be the end of those who do not obey the gospel of God?" Again, I think it's beautiful to see how the Old and the New Testament complement one another. You've heard me say it many times, it's one book. And I'm always fascinated when you see a verse in the Old Testament and you see its New Testament equivalent, which usually says the same thing, just in a little different way, and it might be in a little different context, but the theme is always the same. And it's just beautiful to me how the Bible always ties together so beautifully. But Jeremiah's concerned that God's going to destroy all of Israel, and we know from history and the Bible that God never does that. He always has a remnant. He always has a remnant of people who are faithful to him. Here in Ezekiel, we see those who are marked. In 1 Kings 1:19-18, "Yet I have reserved 7,000 in Israel, all whose knees have not bowed to Baal, and every mouth that has not kissed him." That's where Isaiah has killed the prophets of Baal, and now he's running scared from Jezebel. And he tells God, "Oh, it's just me, I am alone." And God says, you know, basically, "No, you're not. There's 7,000 that you don't even know about who are still faithful to me." God always has that remnant. And then you think of Noah. There's a remnant of 8 people that God saved when all the rest of the world had become totally corrupt. And then we look, if you want to know how much God loves us and the lengths he'll go to, look at Sodom and Gomorrah. He would not destroy Sodom and Gomorrah until the angels got Lot out of there. And if you read those passages very carefully, the angels actually tell Lot, "We cannot do anything until you're out of here," which just is a beautiful demonstration of God's love. So we might could say, so to speak, that Lot was a marked man. And they weren't going to do anything until he was out of there. Only then could God's, because God is not going to, he's not going to come against his own. He loves his children. He's not going to let anything happen to us. He will always pull us out of those circumstances because, again, you can say that we're marked. And then Romans chapter 11, verse 5. Even so then, at this present time, there is a remnant according to the election of grace. And Paul there is actually talking about the what we might call Messianic Jews, the Jews who actually do believe in Jesus. So God has always got a remnant. And in a way, you could say he's got two remnants. He's got the remnant of Messianic believers who are actually will be raptured with the Gentiles. And then he's also got a remnant of the other Jews who will actually wake up during the tribulation and recognize that Jesus is the Messiah. Moving on, chapter 9, verse 9. Then he said to me, the iniquity of the house of Israel and Judah is exceedingly great, and the land is full of bloodshed, and the city full of perversity. For they say, the Lord has forsaken the land, and the Lord does not see. And as for me also, my eye will neither spare, nor will I have pity, but I will recompense their deeds on their own head. You know, we have to remember God is holy, and he wants his people to be holy. And they had reached this level of idolatry and rebellion and everything else that was going on, and they were supposed to be a people set apart, holy. I think it's important for us to remember that. Just then, the man clothed with linen, who had the inkhorn at his side, reported back and said, I have done as you commanded me. It's interesting here that they said God doesn't see. 2 Chronicles 16:9 tells us, for the eyes of the Lord run to and fro through the whole earth, to show himself strong on behalf of those whose heart is loyal to him. And Psalm 44, verses 20 and 21, if we had forgotten the name of our God or stretched out our hands to a foreign God, which they had done, would not God search this out? For he knows the secrets of the heart. And then John 17, 4, I have done as you have commanded me, which sounds familiar from this verse 11 here. The Lord Jesus closed his ministry with the words, I have glorified you on earth, I have finished the work you have given to me. And we see a beautiful picture here. The perfect obedient servant was, of course, Jesus. But here we see this man clothed with linen, this angel clothed with linen, who is also an obedient servant and finished the work God had for him. But it's interesting to think about this, this God not seeing them, because we note here that God took Ezekiel and showed them what the people, the leaders, and the priests were doing in Jerusalem through a vision. So God saw and was showing Ezekiel, and these are the very people who are saying God doesn't see. It's really ironic when you think that through, that they were saying God doesn't see, and God was actually seeing and showing Ezekiel at the time they were saying it in a vision. So I think the message there for us is we have to really, really remember God sees everything we do. He knows every word we're going to say, every word we do say, and every thought we have. And I think that's why Paul will tell us in his epistles to take every thought captive. And the Bible is full of admonitions about our words. If you look in Proverbs, I don't even know how many Proverbs there are about us watching our mouths. So we need to be very careful about what we say. And then the same is true. I mean, Jesus gave us many, many warnings about being careful what we say, as did all of the apostles in their writings. So, you know, we have to ask ourselves, is what I'm saying and what I'm doing here, is it befitting of my Lord and Savior? Because I'm actually supposed to be his representative. So these people who think the Lord doesn't see or there's no God at all are in for some huge, huge surprises, because he knows our every thought, our every word, and our every deed. But we see this judgment come on these idolatrous and rebellious people, and it's really interesting how strong this verse is, verse 9, which we read just a minute ago. The iniquity of the house of Israel and Judah is exceeding great, and the land is full of blood, and the city full of perverseness. For they say, the Lord hath forsaken the earth, and the Lord seeth not. So I think what we're seeing here, when God says it's full, it's reached the point that his patience is worn out, so to speak, putting it in human terms. and the time for their judgment has come, because they're not gonna turn back to him without some sort of prompting from him. So if we think of the whole book of Jeremiah and even Ezekiel up to now, God has warned them again and again and again and again and again and again, too numerous to count times. God knows their heart. He knows if they're going to turn or not. And then, you know, we sort of ask ourselves, they had fallen so deep into depravity and idol worship and stuff, you wonder, how much worse could that have gotten? How many people would they have hurt? How could God let it go on? And then when we think about, they were in the captivity for 70 years, and God told them the reason that he chose 70 years is because they had failed to keep the Sabbath of the land. So we multiply that out, that's 490 years that they were disobeying him, which means all of this had been going on for 490 years. Let's just call that 500 years. Talk about God being patient. 500 years they had been disobeying him and falling deeper and deeper and deeper into idolatry, and it becomes easy to understand that God had to draw a line somewhere. Because again, these were supposed to be his holy people set apart from whom he was going to bring Messiah. And if you think about their condition at the time, how could he bring a Messiah out of that? And they met after the Babylonian captivity, they never fell into idol worship again. It's really interesting because God knows what will work, and this worked. They've made lots of mistakes, just as we all have, just as all nations have, but they never fell into idolatry again after this. So again, it speaks of God's sovereignty. He knows what it's going to take to get us out of our predicaments as well. And I think that's important for us to remember. But if we think about God's chastisement again, Revelation 3:19 tells us, as many as I love, I rebuke and chasten. Be zealous, therefore, and repent. And then Proverbs 3:11-12. My son, despise not the chastening of the Lord, neither be weary of his correction. For whom the Lord loveth, he correcteth, even as a father the son in whom he delighteth. And then lastly, Hebrews 12:8. If God doesn't discipline you as he does all of his children, it means that you are illegitimate and are not really his children at all. Those verses make me actually, I mean, there's a part of me that doesn't like his chastisement, but more and more I'm noticing there's a bigger part of me that actually appreciates his chastisement, because two reasons. Number one, I know he's doing it for my good. And number two, it's a sign of his love, and it tells me I'm his kid. So it tells us here, if he doesn't chasten you when you're going astray, so to speak, then you better be asking yourself, are you illegitimate? Are you really his child? And I heard Charles Stanley talk on this one time, and he was talking about him being chastened, and he said, well, if God's chastening me, I must need it. And you know, I realized that's the attitude we should have. If he's chastening me, I'm his kid, he loves me, I must need it. So I'm really trying to make sure that that's my attitude all the time. But then just to close out these thoughts on judgment, we know from several verses that God is love. It's not that God loves, God is love. And everything he does is rooted in love. Ezekiel 33:11, looking ahead, we see, say to them, as I live, says the Lord God, I have no pleasure in the death of the wicked, but that the wicked turn from his way and live. Turn from your evil ways, for why should you die, O house of Israel? And we see here again, God has no desire to see the wicked die, but there comes a point that they're never going to turn to him, and he knows that, and it's time for judgment, and he certainly knows when those times are. And then 2 Peter 3, verse 9, the Lord is not slack concerning his promise, as some count slackness, but is long-suffering towards us, not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance. So we know that God loves us, and he's very patient, he's very kind, long-suffering, and gracious, but there also comes a time, just like in Revelation, when the Great Tribulation begins. I mean, there comes a time that enough is enough. And I think it's really interesting when we think about God's omniscience and his omnipotence. He knows where those lines are. We don't. And we shouldn't judge people. We shouldn't say that's a lost cause. It doesn't mean you harp on them. You don't want to be rude in trying to lead someone to Christ. Leave those decisions to God. But when the opportunity presents itself, we should certainly share His love. And because He is long-suffering towards them, we would have given up on a lot on some people long before God did. And then it's important, too, to remember all the prophets reminded the people that God wants a righteous people, which we've talked about. National calamity is a punishment for national sin. And it's interesting, as you read through Jeremiah and now Ezekiel, you see this was literally from the bottom up. This rebellion and idol worship and adultery and lying and cheating and unfair scales and all that they were doing was from the common man all the way up through their leaderships and even into the priest of the temple, which is really heartbreaking. But it also helps you understand why God had to take such drastic measures to deal with this. So I was hoping to get to chapter 10 tonight, but I see we're not going to make it. So let's pray. Lord, we thank You for Your book of Ezekiel, Lord. Thank You for showing us how much You love us, but also showing us, Lord, that You are omnipotent, You are omniscient, and that You know everything, God. You know what we need, and I pray that You'll just help us, Lord, to seek Your will and seek Your face. Help us to remember, God, that You love us with a love that is just unfathomable to us, how much You loved us and do love us, that You would send Your Son to become a human on this earth and then to die a death and pay a price that we could not pay. Lord, help us to remember we're Your kids, we're Your own, we're in Your hands. And help us to remember, Lord, that if there is chastening going on, it's for our own good. And Lord, I pray that You would help each of us to thank You and love You for it. In Jesus' name, amen.